educator and resident here in the South Bronx. We're growing our way into a whole new economy, and that's beautiful. Where there are no jobs and no access, now we're creating it. Most of my kids come to me from foster care, homelessness, many have special needs. But when we started really making money at our farmers market, the first thing our kids did is decided we were going to sponsor orphanages. So as much as my kids received, they were able to give. I'm proud of them. My first group of kids came back today on their time to tutor the next generation of kids. So when you give kids experiences, you move them into spheres of success that they've never had. And most importantly, when they come here and get the skills that they need, they become employees elsewhere. We're planting seeds, seeds of hope, seeds of opportunity, and seeds of a new economy. Here in the South Bronx, we are harvesting hope and cultivating minds. Okay, you can hear me. Wonderful. Hello, Virginia Beach. Beautiful. I mean, beaches, the bay. People say, sir and ma'am, and home to the, I mean, that's really remarkable. I got a Yo Pops about a week ago. So thank you for having me, and I am thrilled to be here. So for those who don't know, I come from this beautiful little place, too. It's called the Bronx. And we have all, yes, we have some fellow residents. Great. And so some of you know our wonderful tourist attractions. That little slice is home, and it is home to such wonderful things as 40% of the city's waste, 100% of the Bronx's waste, the sewage treatment plant, a sewage pelletizing plant, 4 electrical power plants, 60,000 trucks, six strip clubs. Did I leave anything out? So, you know, we talk about being the canaries in the coal mine. Well, these are all pictures from walking distance to my school. Rather remarkable. So I'm here to open your eyes today, and I want you to start thinking about the way you're thinking, and I'll start talking fast and I'll start talking slow, and maybe you'll get dizzy, maybe you won't. But let me ask you this. Is this glass half empty or half full? Half full? Good, but you know, we're educators, we're gonna stretch the answer. How can we build on this? You see, because I believe that this glass is 100% full. 100% full of something my kids desperately need. Clean air and clean water. So I want to introduce you to this concept today that I call endless resourcefulness, because I, as a classroom educator, happen to be endlessly resourceful, and I'm sure so are you every day when you get in there, and you know, we make lemonades out of lemons. But endless resourcefulness could be just taking garbage labels and turning it into something productive like this, something that will last forever, because I believe in the multiplier effect. So I'm affectionately known, affectionately, as El Capitan de los Pollitos, the captain of the crazy little chickens. And I have many of them. I'm now at a K-12 school. So in addition to these chickens, which we have in Harlem, I have many others. But I am a parent. I'm a resident. And I have this fundamental belief that kids should not have to leave their neighborhood to live, learn, and earn a better one. Wouldn't it be great if we started building these concentric circles right where we are? So I am this insurgent educator, and I am absolutely committed to meeting kids where they are, and I'm not going to accept the things I cannot change anymore. I'm going to change the things I can't accept, and that's at the heart of what I do. But I have this belief that if kids bring their bodies, their brains will follow. So inherently, school is where it needs to happen. The sad reality is, you know, we've seen this morning how people need to get back outside and get back outside, and I grew up even outside in the schoolyard. Kids are not outside anymore. We are living in the age of nature versus Nintendo, and the reality is no one's even playing Nintendo anymore. It's like Xbox 360 or something new. I don't even know. My VCR says 12 o'clock. But parents, you know this. Nintendo's not with it, and that's 3 years ago. So what's con next? What's the next station? What's the next thing? But in my 20 years in the South Bronx, plus, I'm not going to date myself, so I'll say 20, my kids are getting sicker. My kids are getting fatter. I have 200-pound sixth graders. The emergency room is the primary source of health care in my community, and that's not healthy for anybody. In addition to the proximity of fossil fuels causing learning disabilities, 70% of the kids that I see labeled learning disabled would not be if their parents had simply had access to good prenatal nutrition. So that's something that we can change tomorrow, starting today. Moreover, there are more and more kids who are actually eating themselves to death in this country than starving. starving themselves to death. And that to me is also unacceptable. The realities of my community where I'm making this incredible lemonade look like this. There they are. The average family of six in my community is making about $14,000 a year. Tough place to live. And whether you believe it's design or default, my K-12 school is just two blocks up and two blocks in from that. That's a tough place to go to school. And these are my schoolyards. Great place to be if you're a stray bullet or a broken glass, but you know, in this age of let's move, like what's really incentivizing to get out there and move in that? So I really get what the problems are. And as jobs continue to leave not only my country in America, and energy continues to be imported in on this ridiculous extraction-based economy, no wonder so many urban communities, so many places that brought great industry are now reduced to deserts. So, the one thing we know is constant is change. So while we believe constant is change, really, change is the new constant. Constant. And while, you know, consume, 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 buy, buy more, consumers are going to be sustainers. And yet, if you spent your way into a recovery, please see me after. I would love to buy that program from you. You know, the reality is, sustainers will be the new consumers going forward, and this is the new paradigm we need to address. Now, of course, I like safe. We all like safe. We all sign liabilities and make sure the kids, you know, sign here and get parent approval. But I don't want to just be safe. I want to be transformational. I want to be equitable and I want to be inclusive. And I truly believe in the multiplier effect. And we all talk about sustainability, sustainability. That's the start. Because if I were to ask you, how's your relationship with your husband and your wife, and you turn around and told me it's sustainable, I'd say, well, that sucks. You know, my relationship with aspirational there? I mean, you know, I want inspirational. I want the multiplier effect. My relationship with my wife and my family, God bless them both to hear today, is transformational, and that's what it needs to be. So when I found out that I could grow plants vertically, it got me thinking, I just had to open my eyes to that, because, you know, I'm not really a farmer. And what am I into? Well, this is what we're all into here, and this is why we gathered here today. But today I'm hoping that forever my reach will exceed my grasp. But it all starts with kids, and it all starts in classrooms, and it all starts with seeds. And in my class, in the middle of the South Bronx, we are always planting seeds. And these seeds become plants in the back of the class. And while I love animals, don't get me wrong, nothing here eats its young. Nothing floats at the top of the tank. Nothing bites, and nothing really stinks. So for me, I don't have to scoop any poop. And I think that was great, by the way. But I'm not scooping poop here. And for me, that's a cool thing, because I don't like scooping anyone's poop. And these things grow, they're beautiful, and the kids really feel successful. The kids show up in school and think that, hey, you know, listen, I've got to do this. My plants need me. And guess what? They need them right in my class where I need them. So it's win-win-win. But the remarkable thing is you see how attentive these kids are to these plants. And literally, we pulled up blacktop across the Bronx to grow farms like this. But that, to me, is not exactly sustainable. I wanted them back indoors, so I wanted these farms back in my class, so when I really like to grow and put these plants first, and then food, I'll talk about that later, inside a classroom, that, to me, became the transformational effect. Because my kids were also hungry, in addition to eating, like, 30,000 cheese doodles and soda for breakfast. And lo and behold, we gave birth to the first edible wall in New York City, and my kids realized that if they were hungry, during class, they can get up and eat, and it would grow back. And that was kind of cool, because most kids don't even know where food comes from. You know, they think someone in the bottom of Costco just turned the machine on high. You know, they don't get it. And sadly, in my neighborhood, most food comes through a bulletproof window. So I started pairing this growing of food, if you will, with real authentic project-based learning. And my kids started getting engaged and involved and started passing tests, and we realized that there was a job and a whole economy built in this. And here we are. We went to Boston. We designed this with computers. So it's kind of differentiated, like nature, where every kid had an edge. Some of the constructors, some of the planners, some of the builders, some take care of the plants. But together, we came together as a team, and lo and behold, we started installing walls like this with corporate logos 20 stories up across the country and being able to really make a difference. And we started taking ugly, because I have an ugly institutional building. My building, I'm starting putting in interiors that look like this, which really inspired kids to think about what you could possibly do in school on an ugly wall. And then we started adding in something that was real 21st century. LED lighting, retrofitting, and thinking about jobs that could never be outsourced. Because no matter where you live, whether it's with mom or in foster care, someone's paying for Con Ed. Well, what do you guys call it down here? Electricity. So, you know, my kids really got this. That electricity made a difference, and that lighting was cool, and it really led to jobs. And ladies and gentlemen, this is my harvest in my classroom in New York City. And this is my school of mass instruction. For college-bound kids, I have a bigger one. But this is not just a ticket to good health. This is really a license to print money in so many ways. In addition to just farmers markets and selling food, and while I used to want to sell every pound of food for as little as I could to affect as many people, now I just want to sell 10 pounds for $1,000 a pound and give the rest away. But there's a whole other story. So where does that food go? Well, I work in a scanning school. You can't even take a knife in. So here we are cooking on plastic forks and plastic trays, and my heirloom students are making heirloom sauce in the cafeteria. How cool is that? And just like you guys spoke about, they're measuring, they're predicting, they're calculating, and they're eating things that they grew. Things that are healthy for them, you know, because ketchup is not a vegetable. I'm here to tell you it's not. And the rest of the food, well, where does it go? Right into the cafeteria. But the most important thing is that, you know, for me, the greening of America, unless you believe in, you know, the greening of the industrial prison complex, the greening of America starts with the pockets. Hip National, cabbage in the pockets works. And then it changes hearts and it changes minds. So when my kids started making living wage, it was incredible. And yes, here we are with the first cohort of the youngest nationally certified workforce in America, except for the baby. The baby was just there visiting. But this is my favorite picture because I call this from South Bronx to Southampton. You know, this is our Upper East Side moment. When my kids from the poorest congressional district in America can get out and start putting in roofs and do construction and landscape architecture that looks like this, it's remarkable. And these are my kids. So from the South Bronx to Southampton, this is so cool. And the next thing, and guess what? We got to write them back. We did a good job. People in the Hamptons liked what we were doing. So the following summer, we moved in. That's right. Me and my kids with pants down here had to pull them up. And we moved in. And we started working on homes that looked like this and really applying science and math and engineering and budgeting skills. And these are my kids designing this thing and installing it. And when kids from this poorest congressional district in America can design a roof that looks like this, with sedum that looks like that, that you're growing in a classroom for pennies, that, to me, is the true green revolution. So you may ask yourself, what does this green wall or green wall, you know, green roof technology do besides mitigate the environment, besides change landscapes and mindsets? Well, sometimes you gotta look to corporate America. And this guy right here figured it out. He said, Steve, your farmers are the best source of labor that can never be outsourced. And what does that really mean? It means jobs. So we started training kids to start doing things like windows and weatherization, sealing buildings and replacing floors and doing electricity. Real jobs that can't be outsourced and pay you any wage. And where are we doing it? In our own community. We have tons of abandoned buildings and tons of housing that is substandard. And these are my kids. This is the first one in his family to ever be inside of a bank. That, to me, is remarkable. This young man from Africa speaks three different dialects. He's in love with the technology and can't wait to send it home to his people because he was tired of walking and seeing his family walk every day to get water for subsistence farming. This kid's incredible. And again, when you can take abandoned buildings and turn them into exteriors that look like that with interiors that look like this, it is a true C-Segway moment. So when CNN called and said they wanted to come down and do a story, I said, sure, come on down. I explained to the principal after, not first. I'll do that differently. I moved on from that position. But you know, I like to say, it's unbelievable. Excuse me, I just couldn't resist. But again, when kids from the poorest congressional district can take this technology and infuse it into some of the wealthiest real estate in America, and design a 12-foot by 30-foot green wall in the heart of Rockefeller Center. That's what I call a true si se puede moment, and that represents jobs then, now, and into the future, because it's not only the installation, it's the upkeep, it's the maintenance, and guess what? This wall has become ecotourism. In the heart of Midtown Manhattan, people come from everywhere to see it, which is totally cool. It's scholastic, in fact, if you ask me. I spoke there too, and that to me with 72 plants that became a bunch of salsa and tomato sauce a couple of weeks later in my classroom. I wheeled it down Broadway. You had to see what people were thinking. It was nuts. Well, what does it really look like? Well, when the borough president comes to my classroom, when the Bronx borough president and state senator comes to my classroom, it's proof that the Bronx can. change attitudes now, that we together can change America now. And that to me is what this is really about. This is a very inclusive problem, whether you're living in the city or in the suburbs where kids are getting bigger and sicker daily. This can all change. But then I had this epiphany. You see, because many of my kids are being raised by grandparents, either mom or grandma, and that's a whole nother talk. But we had this concept that if we started feeding grandma and got grandma to school, well, then we could surround kids with all kinds of services, including grandma. Because, you know, in my community, it's not a matter of if, but when you get involved with the police. But grandma swings a very heavy cane in the South Bronx. I will tell you, people do not mess with grandma. So when you feed grandma and grandma comes in and she signs off on your paperwork and she understands what's really going on in school and understands that maybe you didn't tell the truth last week that you were going to school and you got lost for a week, all of this creates concentric circles of accountability that for me, as a teacher, made my life great. No more truancy problems, no more nightmares. It was very local. Grandma came in, it was great. So I realized I was doing something far greater than just growing food. We were really growing for justice. And that was kind of cool. And again, when my kids in the poorest congressional district in America, many of them came to me through this little rash that I call handcuffs. You can get out and help build 100 gardens to spread across New York City. That's a true seasick branding moment. I mean, when you see the inclusivity on that stage, that's a former 911 moment, turn 611, turn 411 informational moment. And that to me is beautiful. And in fact, Lorna said, you call me the Pied Piper of Peas, but in a lyrical sense, when you expand kids' palates, you expand their vocabulary. I just don't want kids to fill the bubble in on the test. I don't want to level scores. I want to level fields. And quite frankly, this is how I'm doing it, because we're expanding their palates and their vocabularies. And again, when my kids from the poorest congressional district can support places in China and Haiti and read about horrible events in the world and want to contribute and start raising money and sending technology around the world, that's a together we can all prosper attitude, and I love it. So we realized in my little neck of the woods that there was something green for everybody. And lo and behold, we gave birth to the Green Bronx Machine. I mean, they even designed the shirts the kids, God bless them. I mean, you know, so every aspect of what they're doing is engaged with some form of literacy and some form of green literacy. The shirt was designed with no child labor. Organic cotton, I can go on and on and on. But, you know, in this era of STEM, and I'm a big believer in STEM, I want to talk about cooking with steam. And what does the A stand for? Well, the A stands for art, aspiration, and advocacy, because the only way we're ever going to move kids from poverty into middle class is to have them do all the above, to advocate and aspire towards it. So what does it look like really? Well, it looks like taking pizza boxes and turning them into chairs. It looks like remapping our community, and this is where it really became involved, because you saw what my community looked like. So we mapped our community. My school is one block in. This is a tough place to live. In the summer, it's hot as hell. In the winter, it's cold. And whenever it rains, the water goes right down that hill into that big pile of garbage I showed you. And where does that go? All around the city. Not good for anybody. We felt we were entitled to more. And that's also why I'm involved with the U.S. Green Building Council, because where we learn matters. But I'll get to that next. And every kid deserves a healthy, nurturing environment. And they deserve to aspire to one. So this is where the art came in. This is where the advocacy came in, because as a community, we came together to write the grant. And here we are breaking ground. And last summer, we are marching up Hunts Point Avenue. That's the block now. And that's remarkable. And if you notice, we have a green lane. Business after business. And that's what I call, as a teacher, the ABCs, asset-based community development, you know, where together we can all prosper. Now, you don't have to live in the South Bronx to understand this. You can be an absentee landlord and still benefit from the fact that, guess what? Bam! This represents energy savings to you guys and jobs for my kids now, forever, and into the future. In addition to bringing butterflies and cute little things that come and lots of food for my kids. So what does it look like? Well, these are my future farmers. These are my kids investigating the South Bronx. And when they grow up young and tenacious like this, it's remarkable, because in the South Bronx, we are feeding kids and families without a food stamp or a fingerprint. And we're doing it efficaciously. So, you know, Toto, kick your heels. Guess what? I'm home, and that's the South Bronx. It's not Kansas. That is the new South Bronx. Now, what does it really look like with kids? And I started this with prison kids and overage, undercredited kids. It really looks like infusing the little guys with this stuff. No more little Knicks or little Nets or little Yankees. I want little broccolis, little mushrooms, little carrots. I want kids to group and aggregate around things that they can actually eat that are going to give them, you know, some kind of positive benefit in life. And again, in the middle of the middle, you can have kids growing tomatoes and identifying them at this young age. That, to me, is remarkable. Most importantly, as a teacher, when Jose can pay attention to details and tell me about the bumps on the cucumber, and Omar and Henry can tell me that carrots come from under the ground instead of through a Ziploc bag with a woman and a mustache throwing them at them in a cafeteria, that, to me, is a moral victory I accept. I embrace that stuff. And again, most importantly, when kids, little kids, see it and taste it and grow it and talk about it, they have this thing that they want. More! And that's good by me. So, you know, I love educating kids. And most importantly, when you get the big, formerly bigger white guy out of the way and start having little Jose accountable to big Jose, this creates the kind of intergenerational accountability that drives this program forward and no longer requires that crazy lunatic champion teacher who's in there early and staying late. Because the kids do it, and they want to do it, and they love it. And I gotta tell you now, I even have my big kids teaching little kids how to shop. How cool is that? You know, we even have a mock EBT machine, you know, but no more bulletproof windows so kids can have a great time experiencing what they need to do, shopping for food and making healthy decisions. These are my Bronx kids. This is my classroom. Behold, this is green arts and crafts. Everything related to something that is saleable, self-funding, entrepreneurial, and cyclic. Because I don't want another brick on the pile. You don't want another brick on the pile. I want something that's going to help grow itself. Ho, 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 Merry Christmas. That's me on the reindeer. I mean, these are our little walls. I have some samples here. But this is what kids are doing in school. You know, teachers are involved. We're growing pumpkin patches on top of the Fortran. You guys get to grow. You know, Virginia Grown is a great movement. My kids don't have too many places to grow. So when we start growing on top of trains, we create awareness. That Thanksgiving, guess what? We ate pumpkin pie. And for those who do the vowel consonant blends, think about this. Calabasa. The kids loved it. There's nothing more thrilling than to eat pumpkin pie with little kids who never had it before. For the rich and affluent, we're also storing koi ponds. We're licensed, bonded, and certified. You can talk to me after. This is a tough commute, but we'll do it for you. But in the middle of cities, we are growing corn to create awareness in the heart of streets. I mean, we're reconfiguring bottles just to teach kids how they can reconfigure the way they use their environment. And it's all educational. No wonder my test scores were up. The kids are in school. They're engaged. I can't answer enough questions in the course of a day. Now, I don't expect every kid to be a farmer. I don't. But I do expect them to read about it, write about it, blog about it, offer outstanding customer service, and man, oh man, do they. And I gotta tell you this, as a protective parent, I'd much rather see kids pollinating plants instead of each other. And there's a lot of learning that comes out of that too, and I'll leave it at that. So these are the kids. This is my classroom. That's the food. Where does it go? 0 miles to plate. It drops right down into my school cafeteria. And then I always give the principal credit because, you know, that's the smart thing to do. So always give everybody credit when everybody likes it. Don't take any and you'll stay employed forever. The rest goes locally to soup kitchens and shelters where, sadly, many of my kids get 2 meals a day on weekends. So it's very inclusive. And the wildest thing is we're doing this all across the South Bronx. No Air Jordans were ever ruined on my farm. And that's important because, you know, farming and good sneakers can exist, coincide. And in South Bronx, that's important. The basketball court can exist next to the farm. And toxic waste field, brownfield, cement, we're proving in the South Bronx you can grow food efficaciously and profitably anywhere year-round while generating academic results. My flower sales put big sales to shame in ways that make dollars and cents. We take orders all year round. 99 cents worth of seeds will get you $2,000 worth of plants and a whole lot of kids paying attention to when they're ready to sell them and really make teachers and parents nuts. But again, when you can bring kids from diverse backgrounds together like this, and trust me, this is about as diverse as you can get beyond the picture, to come together for something like that, this is what I call a true C-Safe moment. So let me tell you about the kids. From 40% attendant to 93% attendant, 100% of my kids graduate high school and go on to either college or a living wage job. That to me, yes, thank you. That to me is what it's all about. But this model is replicable because this stuff, including food security, can never be outsourced. Happy kids, happy families, happy colleagues. Behold, the glory and bounty. That's a Bronx watermelon on cement. Go bigger. I mean, you know, we're doing this. I grow 7 kinds of mint in my class, so I ask the kids to differentiate. And then the really smart one says, Mister, You could probably make candy out of this. I mean, you think? Do you mind eating some and changing your breath? I mean, you know, but I mean, you can do with kids. On their drill, they get involved. And what do you do with the rest? Well, you put it in a pot and you tell them to eat it. And guess what? They will and they do. Now, there's this myth that, you know, marginalized communities and low-income communities want more fast food. We don't. Okay, we just, you know, we've got to change that mindset. And here, you know, look, at our farmers markets, we sell out. I mean, it's remarkable. We sell out daily. We can't get enough if you offer it at the right price. And this is locally grown produce. Now we're looking at all sorts of new technology. In a minute, I'll show you something even newer. You know, just ways to get kids thinking about it, the record keeping, the economics, the whole bit. You know, I like to say the borough that gave birth to baggy pants and funky fresh beets is now home to organically grown red ones. You know, and I'm constantly looking at new technologies, ways for kids to get involved. This thing called Google is amazing. Don't let one kid with ADD have unlimited access. You'll be up for weeks. You know, but they are. They're building things. And I got to tell you something. You know, 30,000 pounds of vegetables later, my favorite crop is organically grown citizens, graduates, members of the middle class, kids who are aspiring to things they never did before. And these are my Green Avengers. So help us go from ugly yards that look like that to cash-producing entities that look like this. Half goes for high-end at high prices. The other half goes right into the community while paying living wages for everybody. Win, win, and win. We like that. So, yes, I'm from New York, and I am a former literacy teacher, so I couldn't resist. But I won't read to you, because don't you hate being read to? So, okay, my minute's up. But no matter what city you're from, no matter where you're from, I believe all of us are dedicated to this. And that to me is what it's all about, healthy outcomes. And healthy outcomes have a million different manifestations. Just make sure they're data-based, please. So I don't see walls in my community. I see places to grow opportunity. And I will tell you this, that when you expose kids to what their community is, when you teach them to envision it, and understand that they take ownership of it and look at it in ways they never imagined. And now we spend time looking at prototypes to design green schools. But the bottom line is it's simple math. Cultivate, propagate, and replicate, and keep it moving. You know, I'm very upset about this whole bit with bottles and recycling, you know, the sugar-sweetened beverage industry, supporting kids, you know, you have to buy 30,000 bottles of something to get a free t-shirt. You know, when all of that could be replaced, and we talk about, you know, this is a simple water bottle. You know, simple things in schools that are going to drive performance and reduce consumption are critical. When you think that 40% of the food that we grow in this country is grown basically to wind up in the garbage, that to me is a whole other crime, but that presents a whole opportunity to make compost and sell it to rich people for money, you know, which is totally cool. I love that. But I can't bear to see this on the streets of New York City or anywhere else, so please, fellow educators, if you see it, put an end to it. I want to tell you about this. This was my toilet paper project. Because, yeah, the kids are always blowing their nose with a trail. Mr. Anything, and I come. So we ran out of money for arts and crafts. Ran out, it happens. It wasn't a priority. So I had this idea. Could everybody use one square of toilet paper less? And we started saving. Now, there are some kids who are like, Mr., I'm never going to wipe again. I'm like, great, just leave the paper there. But, and you know those kids. You know those kids. But we all have a hand in this, so to speak, I told them. And we can all contribute. And literally, this is what one square of toilet paper a day aggregated over time looks like. So, to have a lot of energy, please help me use it. I'm delighted to share it. But most importantly, when we teach kids how they can save energy and conserve energy, it becomes this massive competition. And this gentleman hit the nail on the head. When you start seeing parents get a reduction in bills at home and kids become these little energy vampires pulling things out, shutting down the screen, looking at motion sensors, it is so cool. Oh, so I went too ahead of myself. So, that's the point I want to make. Really, teaching conservation is cool because we've been taught consumption for so long that this is actually novel to save something and watch it aggregate over time. The kids get a big kick out of it in terms of cost savings. So I want to show you what 5 days in the life of my green bronze machine looks like and compare it to 5 days in the sea. This is 5 days in the sea. This is 5 days in the life of green bronze machine in the heart of Harlem. Abandoned lot. 5 days worth of growth, 25 days later, no wonder we're Bronx proud. And ladies and gentlemen, you can all do this anywhere and everywhere across the country. I like to say we're farming and you know it. But here we go. Everybody has buildings that look like this. I gravitated to this one because it had a naturally occurring green roof. And I didn't see it as an obstacle. I really started an identifying factor so where everyone would know to come. Now that a dime of retrofitting, we just moved in. Please follow them on Facebook. Now you're gonna think you may be writing to me. You're not. Everyone said, Steve, I've been writing you, I'm writing you. Can you remind what we're talking about? She's 14, the girl who's maintaining the site. And that's the cool thing. I mean, there are ways to look at ways to get kids to aggregate around this. I do the Twitter, but the kids do the Facebook, so please like them. They're trying to get to some crazy number. It's very important for them. You'll find out lots of information. I do have a TED Talk. I encourage you all to see it and send it out there. Not because I'm it for me, because this is the power of what all of us together collectively can do. If I can do it, I'm not special. I'm just dedicated, just like you who came here today on your time to do this. But starting tomorrow, get this out of schools, please. This thing has got to go. This is a simple, please put this on your to-do list. You know, cheap food is so damn expensive and it's killing us. And it's killing kids. Oh, I'm gonna give you a cookie. I mean, come back and see me in a week, but this stuff has got to go. It is killing me. Teach kids to stay out of places that look like this. This is just egregious. And model a healthy plate, model healthy food. Kids were looking at us. I stopped eating McDonald's because I was tired of these kids teasing me about coming out of there when I started driving 30 miles for a 99-cent hamburger. Not to be outed, I realized that too was not manageable. I needed 12-step calling for fast food. This is local food. Vegetate your kids. Have them understand what a fruit stand looks like. Entrepreneurial skills are huge, and if you set up in the right neighborhood at the right price, at the right place, you're going to sell out. And teach them about culinary. Wonderful restaurants in downtown here, but culinary represents an opportunity for everybody. And most importantly, for second opportunity kids or kids who haven't succeeded, you know, neither jail nor retail is a living wage, but becoming a good chef can, is, and will be. And people really don't care if you messed up in the past, as long as you're showing up to work clean and sober, so it's a wonderfully forgiving career. And most importantly, love them. Kids really respond to love, I will tell you, because I've experienced it myself. And as we continue to see, you know, large vocational schools being closed down, you know, the country, we've got some issues as a country. We've got to look at that, but when you see big, beautiful schools like that turning into homeless institutions that look like this, for me, this has got to go. So I'm determined to change that, and I believe facilities like this can be revamped to look like this, grown food, teaching kids aspiration, art, and advocacy in ways we've never imagined. So apropos to you with this quote, because to me, Sandy and Katrina and all these natural disasters prove to me one thing. That no pack group can really bribe the laws of nature. And therein lies my eternal optimism, is we've got to get it right. The kids are waiting for us to get it right, or they've got to get it right, because we just can't proceed as normal. You know, normal has not been too good. So the fact that no pack group, no matter where we stand, can bribe the law of nature really inspires me. So I'm asking that now more than ever, we go from a nation of red states and blue states to a united nation of green states, living ecologically. Years later, people, here we are. We're still here. And while the greatest divide in our country for many and for most still has to do with race, strand that out. What is it really about? Race and the environment and education. And that's in fact why I'm thrilled to be working with the U.S. Green Building Council, because every child everywhere deserves a safe, healthy, nurturing environment. And where we learn matters. And please, get involved in some shape, manner, or form on September 28th for the Green Apple Day of Service. But at the end of the day, it is easier to raise healthy children than fix broken men. And that's what compels me out of my bed every day and turns me into CEO of what I do, the Chief Eternal Optimist, because I know I can make a difference, you can make a difference, we can make a difference. Superman isn't coming. I'm here to tell you that. Here are the facts, people. We're teachers, we're educators, and this is the facts. And to me, that's remarkable that 25% of the population across America steps inside of a school every day. That 50% of every single American household has someone either going to school or working in a school. That 72% of Americans are committed to seeing greener schools in this generation. And that 82% of all Americans, that's not me, that's Carnegie Mellon, say that people are more likely to be consumers of companies and corporations that support public education. That, to me, is market share. I like those odds. That's inspiring to me, and that means we have to embrace a new mindset to use our collective capital to drive this thing forward in ways we've never imagined. Thank you for nodding your head. I appreciate that. So, there are some people who see this, and I understand that. There are some people who see that turning into this. But I'm here to tell you that I see it like this, because opportunity is now here, and this is our moment. So I'm here to share with you before I close one great idea, and it's a simple one. I don't need another 12-point management plan to tell me how to run my classroom. I don't need another blue ribbon commission to come in and tell me what's wrong. I want to focus on what is right. And I believe that together we can all prosper, that the corporate, public, and private sectors should come together to support public schools and look to our generation of kids as the next generation of environmental problem solvers. Either that or we're all moving into your house and we'll help you renovate. So I ask you this, is the glass half empty or is it half full? Exactly, it's 100% full. Now this little guy, remember him? He has put a lens on sustainability that everyone in America knows where he's from. 45 years ago, people thought he was crazy. So even though we're all little tadpoles right now, I want you to take this big green leaf and be a frog. Embrace your outer green roof. Here I am in Harlem growing more corn than I know what to do with the former children of the corn. Embrace the greenhouse. Grow something. This is a 25-foot green wall in a former parking lot under a subway station. Remarkable what you can do to create, you know, aspiration and inspiration. Here I am in another green roof. This is four stories up in an abandoned factory. That's the U.S. State Department. They couldn't believe that my kids were actually doing it. So they brought a team of journalists to come down to check out. Plant a seed. Work with little kids. Every child in America needs to know where their food comes. Every household in America needs to know that he can grow food. And every child in America deserves an opportunity like this. And every child deserves access to clean air and clean water. We're trying to gather some momentum for a national documentary because I believe we can take this across the country no matter where we are. You know, it's remarkable. A couple of months ago, I showed people in the heart of the Rockefeller Center that's impossible to, you know, eat your way to good health. And now I want to show you something that I'm looking at. This new piece of technology, which is, believe it or not, made in America, and even smaller than a green wall, only uses 7 watts of electricity. Those are the starts. That's the finish, and you pop out. My God, let's get back to our roots, people, and grow something together. This is absolutely incredible, and every kid can name their pet. I'm loving it. I'm having such a good time. So there I am. But most important, whatever you do, please, together, let's all get to our own personal side of paradise, our own, you know, little Sesame Street where the air is clean and everybody's green. It's easy. That's what it's about, and that's what we do every day. And I believe that social sustainability and living wages is at the heart of what's going to be innovation, and innovation is at the heart of what's going to change America, where together we can all prosper. Win, win, and win. Now, I have gone from impossible because I just want to share how easy this mindset is. I went from impossible, and for those of you who saw my TED Talk, this is the shirt. So I have gone from impossible to I'm possible. If I can lose the weight by eating the food that I grow with kids in school, so can you and so can they. And that's what it's all about. And the bottom line is this. Our most precious resource is our children. And as we get ready to start another year, you know, some of us are still celebrating graduations. I'm luxuriating in some of my own. But I want to focus on the class of 2025. Because we have gone so obviously from decades of lost opportunity, precipitously close, I'm afraid, to what may be the decade of the last opportunity. So we owe these kids more. We owe us more. And the bottom line, people, is Superman isn't coming. In the words of Martin Luther King, we are the ones we are waiting for. I, me, you, us, together, we can do this. And these guys deserve it, but we need you. So, are you ready? When I say people, you say power. People?
Power!
People?
Power!
Right. Please remember to embrace this mindset of endless resources, no matter what you teach, who you teach, and where you teach, because together we can do this. And remember, this earth is all about art, and we need to treat it as art. Ladies and gentlemen, I am the weed that wants to succeed. I am the city resilient from the heart of urban America, and my journey has taken me everywhere from the South Bronx and now to you, but no matter where you go, please take time to smell the flowers, especially if you and your kids grow together. I'm Steve Ricks, I got passion for my plants, and I'm not afraid to show it. I'm from the South Bronx, and I'm farming, and you know it. Thanks so much.